Hello everyone, I'm Dan Neufer, author of CFS Unraveled, and today I share with you a special interview with the head of a clinic that has been successfully treating patients with ME/CFS and fibromyalgia for over 10 years now. After I published CFS Unraveled, I continued to get messages and emails from people who've read my book, with whom the book resonated, and who subsequently sought help from the Optimum Health Clinic. And they kept telling me that the Optimum Health Clinic shares many of my views, and this interview is a result of these repeated emails I keep getting. The head of the clinic is Alex Howard, who himself recovered after many years of ME/CFS. This is the first time that Alex and I have spoken, and it indeed turns out that we do share a lot of our views. We discuss the need for a change of funding and treatment for everyone suffering with ME/CFS and fibromyalgia, and how patients have been terribly let down and neglected by the system. We also talk about why psychology plays an important part in recovery, even though this is clearly a physical illness and not a psychological illness. We also discuss how people become jaded after many years of illness, and we talk about the insights that Alex has gained about recovery after treating thousands of patients in the clinic over the last 10 years. We touch on the important need for evidence-based medicine and medical trials so that more of these effective protocols can be shared in the medical community, and hopefully so that funding can become available and more people get access to treatments. So I hope you gain many insights from the interview and that you enjoy it. If you like, please leave a comment underneath the video. Thank you. Further ado, let me welcome Alex. Hi Alex, how are you doing?
Hi Dan, how are you doing? Good to talk to you.
Yeah, great to talk to you. Alex, you know, one of the first things that people said when I read my book is they said, you really understand what it's like. Because this is really a very important part, I think, for people who have ME/CFS or fibromyalgia. You actually recovered from ME yourself many years ago. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. So going back many years, back to 1995 and 1996, I had symptoms of ME chronic fatigue, where I pretty much woke up one morning, felt like if there was an energy plug into my body, someone had pulled it, and initially thought it was a virus or kind of flu or something like that. Went to the GP on a number of occasions, as most people do in that situation, and you know, it gradually became clear that I had something, Patrick said, a bit more sinister than just a kind of normal bug. And really, if you fast forward 2 years, very little had changed, apart from the fact that having been severely chronically ill with chronic exhaustion, headaches, muscle pains, those kind of things for a couple of years, I reached a point which I was pretty seriously depressed. And I wasn't ill because I was depressed. I was depressed because I was ill. I'm sure yes. People listening will kind of understand that. Now, one of the ways that we would describe it is that someone who has depression, all they want to do is get into bed and hide away from the world. Someone that has ME chronic fatigue, all they want to do is get out of bed and come out into the world. And that was very much kind of my experience. And you know, prior to that, as a teenager, I lived really for three things, which were music, sport, and girls, generally in that order, I would guess. And to not be able to do the things that I love to do, and to be spending most of the day housebound and a lot of the day bedbound, I really reached the point that I just couldn't see how I was going to continue. I wouldn't say that I wanted to die, I just didn't want to continue living the way that my life was. So I reached a point that I was helped to realize that if I continued to wait for somebody else to find the answers to the situation, then I was in danger of waiting the rest of my life, and that didn't feel like a very cheery prospect at 18 years old. So with the kind of naivety and kind of arrogance that comes from being young, I decided that I was going to find a way to recover from being ill, and spend really the next 5 years pretty much obsessively and kind of incessantly reading and studying and trying everything that I could to find a way out of ME chronic fatigue. And in that time, I saw 30, 35 different practitioners, read hundreds of books, did numerous courses, at one point was taking about 70 supplements a day. I mean, I just did everything that I could find that I felt was possible was going to make a difference. And, you know, we're talking the late 1990s, up to kind of 2001, 2002. So back then, it was a very different climate in terms of ME chronic fatigue. There were very few stories of recovery. These days, you know, there's a lot of stuff you could find which is very inspiring, but there was very little like that. And a lot of the more recent breakthroughs hadn't happened. So it was early days of what I would consider a kind of a whole new wave of things that happened over the last kind of decade or so. Mm. But I was fortunate to find a number of different things that that worked for me. And eventually went on and made a full recovery. And on the other side of being ill, really, like I guess Dan, you're experiencing a lot of people that have been through that kind of experience, I wanted to create something that could support other people in the same situation. And I desperately had wanted an organization that really cared about the patient and was kind of innovative and trying different things and wasn't fixated on one particular approach. And I wrote a book about my experience, started seeing a few patients, and then the whole thing just snowballed. Mm. And you know, it's nearly 10 years since, I think it is about 10 years now since the organization started. And in that time, we treated literally thousands of patients in over 35 countries, had some major research published, and it's been, you know, in a sense, much of the success of the organization has been because of the people that have been drawn into the vision, that have been through similar kinds of experiences.
Yeah, I hear this story repeatedly about, it seems that we all have a very similar experience in some sense, when we go through the illness, and the frustration of not being heard, and the frustration of the cookie cutter quick sort of medical treatments which people are not necessarily responding to. So having a practice that really goes into more depth is really what most people are looking for, but they can't always access it. And I guess one of the challenges is also the physical divide. If people live far away or they live in another country, but by the sound of it, you're actually treating people even who are overseas. Is that right?
Yeah, we do a lot of work by video Skype. We have patients, say, in 35 or so countries, and we do the best we can. It's much easier, in a sense, from a psychology perspective, because pretty much all of the work is involved in kind of dialogue between a practitioner and a client. On the more nutritional side of what we do, it has its complexities in terms of finding laboratories and supplement providers and that kind of thing. But we've been fortunate that the organizations we work with in the UK have been very flexible in working with patients abroad. Certainly in places like the US and places like Australia and that kind of thing, New Zealand, there are similar kind of organizations in at least some of those components. Mm-hmm. And even in the UK, certainly initially, quite a lot of people that we treat are not well enough to come to the clinic. So even with, you can have someone that only lives an hour away, but you still have to do distant treatment to start with because that's all they're able to do. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so look, what are the different aspects of treatment that you actually look at when you talk to your patients?
Well, I think the first thing I would say is that from my perspective, ME chronic fatigue fibromyalgia is a hugely complex group of illnesses, and every person is different in terms of their unique life story and experience, but also their own biochemistry and their own physiology in terms of what's happening. And it's also true to say that there are patterns that you find when you start, especially in a sense, the more people you work with. On one hand, you see more complexity, and on the other hand, you can also see more simplicity because you see these patterns kind of spreading across much of the population. And it's true to say that there are people that don't fit within those kind of pictures, and in a sense, they're the ones that we learn the most from. So the patients that come to us that they may have seen many other people previously, they come to us, they don't respond initially to the standard things that we would do, and they assume that we're going to give up on them like other people have done. Actually, that's where protocols tend to move forwards. And, you know, we get less of those people as the years go by because we've seen so many of them historically. In terms of the specifics of the treatment that we do, we focus on two main areas. We focus a lot on the psychology side, and that's not to say, and I guess, Dan, your viewers or listeners are kind of aware of some of these concepts. I hope it's not too controversial to say that.
No.
From the perspective that we look at from the psychology point of view, it's not that ME chronic fatigue is a psychological illness. It's that often it has a big effect on someone's psychology, and going through the mind and the emotions can also be a very powerful way of affecting the body. So we have a psychology department that has a whole approach and way of working on that side. We also have a nutritional therapy department, which do a lot of functional medicine work. So looking, you could say that from a traditional medical perspective, you'd be looking at when something's fundamentally broken in the body. So, for example, adrenal fatigue from the perspective of traditional medicine will be looking at something like Addison's disease. You haven't got that in your adrenal supply, and we'd look at what's called suboptimal function.
There seems to be no bell curve in Western medicine. It's more of a either you're completely sick or you're completely fine, and they don't seem to realize there's an in between.
Yeah, right, exactly. So there's a whole way of looking at kind of suboptimal functioning, and so we have a team of practitioners focusing on that side as well. And generally, the interventions would be via diet and supplements based upon the kind of functional medicine testing. We also, I would say that from my perspective, there's definitely a role for traditional medicine. I definitely would see a subgroup of patients, for example, can benefit from low-dose antidepressants and those kind of things. Something I never would have said 10 years ago, but as a student of science, you can't ignore the fact there are certain patients that stabilizes them enough to be able to engage in other kinds of ways of working. And then I would say there are many other things that sit outside of the way that we work, which definitely can also have benefit. But I would say they're not the kind of core part of what, in my experience, tends to make the difference. So I definitely see patients benefit from things like acupuncture, things like yoga, and they definitely have their place. They're not things that we do directly in the clinic, partly because we're very much set up to work with people remotely and do distance-based treatments, and those things don't lend themselves to that. But also, we tend to really focus on the core pieces that seem to make the difference. Mm-hmm. And our thing over the years has really been to study what works. And that's really what's kind of driven our approach.
How do you, you mentioned adrenal fatigue and treating with supplements, and there are many different views on this type of a treatment. And I'm just kind of curious, what sort of supplements do you actually consider?
So it's not my area of speciality, so I'm happy to give some comments on it,
sure.
But the nutrition team would kind of have more specific answers. So we generally wouldn't do any adrenal work without testing first. So I see, you know, there's certainly a lot of people that will come in that have self-prescribed stuff, and they put themselves on all kinds of potent adrenal supplements that either they may not need or maybe too high doses. So I would say that a lot of people within the chronic fatigue ME population, they tend to be hypersensitive. And so often you need much lower doses to have an effect. And if you take too many adrenal supplements, actually just give you a lot more anxiety if it's not kind of managed in the right way. So we use a range of different adrenal supplements. We certainly use some glandulars, which you may well have come across, which we can definitely get good results with. I'd also say that sometimes it can be a bit of trial and error with patients to find a supplement that's going to work for them. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you'll be aware of Dr. Wilson's protocols, and so his has been one of the areas that's influenced us. And I would say there's a percentage of our patients that can't tolerate those supplements.
Yes.
And so there are lighter options which are also used as well.
Yes. Yeah, I think Dr. Wilson's is probably the only one that I've actually subscribed to personally. And I think one of the key distinctions is in his adrenal supplements that he actually removes the hormones, which I think is a really important part. Do you actually do a lot of hormonal treatments as well in the clinic, or do you steer away from messing with that sort of thing too much?
When you say hormones, do you mean HRT, like hormone replacement therapy, or do you mean kind of more natural alternatives?
Well, I'm talking like hydrocortisone or thyroid hormones and all this type of...
Yeah, so we certainly have natural versions of those things that we will look at. I've seen evidence that actual kind of medically kind of prescribed HRT, so for example, hydrocortisone, those kind of things, can help some patients. I'd say it's an area that we need to do more research, and I say we, I mean the kind of research community. I think one of the things I'm mindful of around those kinds of things is that the danger is it doesn't always support an actual healing of the underlying issue that's going on. So it can support the system, and that definitely has a place. But I think that's better alongside a deeper healing of what's going on. And I think that's also where that kind of work in association with some kind of psychological work can be important, because what can happen is someone can crash their an element of their endocrine system, for example, their adrenals, and you can give more support to the adrenals. But if all that extra energy that's put in is just being spent, you don't actually get a healing of what's happening. So you end up with someone effectively almost addicted to having to take those products. Mm. If someone can get the body into a healing and that healing state, and they can rest as that additional energy comes in, there can be a healing process that happens, and that's a much healthier way of approaching it.
Alex, I can see why people have suggested I have a chat to you, and we indeed do have a lot of commonality. I mean, one of my concerns has always been too that if that adrenal support is used at the wrong time, you know, it's my personal view that may actually be detrimental. And counterproductive, because in some ways I think adrenal fatigue is actually kind of saving us from doing further damage. It doesn't feel good, but it may not necessarily be bad for us just because it feels bad. Tell me, have you found that there are certain type of a certain subset in the people that come and see you? Do you find that people have certain commonalities that are worth mentioning in terms of their backgrounds or in terms of their diets and things of this nature?
I mean, I literally feel like we see almost everything. I mean, we had a practitioner meeting a few weeks ago when we came up. I think the youngest current patient we have in the clinic is 11 or 12 years old, and the eldest patient we have is in their 80s. And is it true that we have more women than men? Maybe marginally, but I was looking at my own patient group last week. I had a whole day of only male patients. So it's kind of, I would say that, you know, any point can affect anyone. I would say from my perspective, what I definitely see is it tends to affect a higher percentage of people which have certain psychological tendencies, for example, people that tend to push themselves very hard, people that tend to place sort of other people's needs above their own, or people that tend to have a tendency towards anxiety, mainly because there are certain ways of someone approaching their life which deplete the system. And if you do that for a long enough period of time, something snaps in the system. It's like a fuse that goes and suddenly the system crashes.
Sure.
So there are certain tendencies and certain clusters of kind of personality types that we would see. And there are certain occupations that lend themselves to those kinds of personalities. For example, we see a lot of teachers, which isn't necessarily people that are driving themselves hard on the achiever side, but they maybe have the helper tendency. And also, I don't know how it is in Australia at the moment, but certainly in this country, teaching is a pretty brutal profession in terms of all the additional paperwork that's being put in, all the pressures that are put on teachers, all the demands. And so there definitely seems to be a lot of teachers, for example, that are burning out. Okay. That's true of many, I don't know, just focus on one profession, because there are many, many professions. And in a sense, you can have someone that's not in an externally stressful environment that responds in themselves in a stress-induced way, and therefore that becomes a source of burnout. Mm. You know, so it is a kind of, sorry, Mike, let me just unplug my landline phone. Sorry.
Okay, no problem.
Sorry, Dan, that's not high pressure of an interview, but anyway.
That's okay, so, I've been caught up myself, yeah.
so, I've been mindful not to kind of draw too many conclusions. In the sense, these are the kind of statistics that would be interesting for us to run of our own patient group.
Yes.
Certainly, in the wiser kind of ME chronic fatigue world, there are certain distinctions that come out. But I think what we're talking about ultimately is something which is a product of partly modern living, where there's constant pressure, constant stress, constant pushing of people in a way which is different to what would have happened historically. And without wanting to go too far off on a tangent, I would say that what we're seeing in the current economic situation, the current environmental situation, is a macro version of what we see in the micro experience of ME chronic fatigue. It's an unsustainable way of living, which eventually has to crash in some kind of way. Mm. And that's really how I see ME chronic fatigue fibromyalgia. From one perspective, it is a process of living in a way which is unsustainable, that eventually the body can't sustain, something snaps, and then you have to find a new way of engaging. That doesn't mean that on the other side of recovery, someone has to live this very carefully limited life, but it's finding a new way to relate to the world.
Yes. Yeah, look, what you say is what is echoed by just about every person that I speak to that has actually recovered. This new way of relating to the world and engaging differently. And more often than not, I hear people say that they come out the other end a happier person, which I always feel like must be a bit of pill to swallow for anyone listening, because obviously whilst you're sick, you can't imagine anything good coming out of it, especially when you've been sick a long time. Let's talk a little bit more about recovery. People obviously always have the concern that perhaps others can recover, but they can't. And there's all kinds of things, you know, that they might tag that onto. I just had a question this last week. It was very specific about older people recovering. And of course, we appreciate that people with other health challenges or with longer histories may have a deeper, a more ingrained version, if you like, of the illness. But then again, that is not necessarily the case, I believe. Have you? Can you make any sort of comments about recovery in terms of people? In terms of what ages you've seen people recover, or in terms of how long they've been ill? Would you like to make any comments in that regard?
Sure. I mean, firstly, I would say we have a team of a dozen practitioners working full time at ME chronic fatigue. So over 10 years and thousands of patients, I've seen everything. So I've seen people that have been ill for 30 years, tried everything, thinking they're never going to recover in a remarkably short period of time, and people that look like the simplest case be highly complicated.
Yeah.
So I think from the perspective of the individual, I would say that it's difficult to believe in recovery until you have some kind of evidence that it's possible for you. And I talk about a kind of continuum from hoping to believing to knowing. And initially, all you can really do is hope that you're going to recover. And hoping is kind of like, there's a chance you will, there's a chance you won't, but you're kind of hoping that you will. As you start to get some evidence, i.e. you try certain inventions that have an effect and you feel a difference in terms of your physical energy, in terms of your nervous system, then you maybe start to believe that you're going to recover. Because you think about like beliefs being like a table, and the evidence is the legs to the table. You've got some legs to that table now. So you start to believe, actually, wow, this is becoming possible. So the idea that you will recover feels more solid than the idea that maybe you won't recover, but there's still a question mark around it. Mm. When you know you're going to recover, that's normally because you're so far down the line, you have so much clear evidence that there's very little question about it. But I think it's dangerous for people to think that you won't recover if you don't believe you're going to recover. Mm. Because I think in the whole kind of pop psychology world, the whole thing about belief gets really overstated. And the thing that I say to people, if you really believe that belief defines everything, try standing on the roof of your house and flapping your arms and jumping off and believe you can fly and see what happens. It's like belief doesn't override the laws of gravity or the laws of the world.
Yeah.
But what belief does do is, if you don't believe you can do something, you're unlikely to take action to move forward.
Yeah.
So belief gives you the capacity to go, I believe this is possible, therefore I'm going to take certain steps and then see what evidence I get. Then if you collect evidence, then you start to believe more strongly that something's possible. So, it's it's really interesting. You know, we have a website something called secretsrecovery.com of many, many patient recovery stories. And there are people that have gone through dozens and dozens of these stories in great detail and then emailed and said, you haven't got a story the same as mine, therefore I don't believe I'm going to be able to recover.
Right.
And it's like, right. I would say back in the time that I was ill and that I was saying earlier, there's kind of this, the beginning of this wave of kind of this belief around recovery, there weren't stories of recovery from ME chronic fatigue. And so I borrowed stories from people that recovered from cancer and from diabetes and AIDS and those kind of things and took inspiration from that. So there's a kind of, I think it's dangerous when people get overly fixated on someone having to convince them that they're going to be able to recover. I think what's more important is starting from where you are and then taking sensible, practical, well-considered steps forward and then approaching it like a scientist. You don't have to believe it's going to work for it to work, but you do have to take the action to collect that evidence.
Yes. Yeah, look, I wholeheartedly agree. It is all about the action. And, you know, I can say that I've actually spoken to people who were actually wholeheartedly convinced it was not possible and what they were going to do was not going to work. But it did work because they wanted to prove that it doesn't work. And so in order to prove that it doesn't work, they had to take the steps. And so they still ended up with results. So I wholeheartedly agree with you. The key thing is action. As long as you can find some way of taking action, you can see, you have the possibility of change.
And I think one of the things I would also say is that I think a lot of people that are going through ME chronic fatigue fibromyalgia, they're very reluctant to believe in something, not because they're inherently a negative person. In fact, probably part of the reason why they crashed is they were someone that was overly positive. They believed they could do more than they could, and their body gave them feedback, otherwise known as getting ill. So the skepticism and the cynicism is not because that's inherently how they are. It's because they've tried a number of things that haven't worked, and it becomes painfully disappointing when you invest energy, and especially when you invest limited finances in something that doesn't deliver what you expect. So after a while, people start to become skeptical and cynical as a defense and a protection against disappointment. That's something that when patients come into the Optimum Health Clinic, we take very carefully, take very seriously. We don't try and override that. We don't try and debate with people around it. We simply do the best we can to present the information that we've got for them to make an informed decision and to gradually explore for themselves their own kind of cynicism and their own skepticism, because maybe it is true that we can't help them. And I'm not going to kind of sit there, you know, in a debate trying to convince somebody. We don't have all the answers. We certainly have a lot of answers, and we've certainly helped a lot of people, and we've certainly had some incredible stories of recovery and some people that haven't necessarily reached full recovery but have massively improved their quality of life in such a way that the whole fixation upon recovery kind of drops away. You know, it's kind of extraordinary when someone's been ill, let's say, for 15, 20 years and they're at a kind of 30% level of functionality and they're totally obsessed about full recovery. But actually, if that person moved from 30% to 70%, their whole life is transformed.
Absolutely.
And okay, there may be still more work to do and more things to happen over time, but it's like people get very black and white in their thinking that it's like, I have to make this full recovery. And of course, many, many people make full recoveries. I made a full recovery, people work. And they have many, many, many patients. But I think it's a dangerous fixation for people sometimes because it becomes an obsession which actually takes away from taking the steps of where they are and getting that information and moving forwards, which then builds the foundation for a potential full recovery.
Yeah, look, very wise words, Alex. I mean, it's so easy for people, like you said, to get overly skeptical or harsh in their judgment of people's recovery. But how can there be anything bad about somebody going from 30% to 70%? And any improvement, any significant improvement like that is something that we should be celebrating and trying to move towards. So even if you believe that recovery is possible, believing it for yourself can be quite a different thing. I can say from my own experience that when I did all my research and I came to this understanding, that I suddenly thought, wow, I think based on what I've learned, I definitely think it's possible to recover. I hadn't met anyone yet, but I thought this must be possible. But for me to think that I could recover, it's a different thing, because we have our own experience. And I can actually, I'm happy to share that even as I was recovering, I still had difficulty envisaging myself as being a healthy person again after all those years. So people talk about the power of visualization, which I think is very important. It's very useful. But if you can't do it, that's okay. It doesn't mean you won't recover. So even when I remember walking down the road, being quite healthy and strong and, you know, getting really fitter and everything, and when I tried to think about myself as a healthy person, even though I kind of was already there, I still struggled. And yet, you know, I have a full recovery.
I think probably also worth saying that, you know, and maybe I'm preempting a question here, but I think there's something around different things work at different stages of recovery. Yeah. So what also happens is that somebody finds something which has really helped them, and maybe, for example, it's taken them from 30 to 70%. And maybe, for example, that's something like they were constantly putting everyone else's needs first, and they recognized they needed to go to a much quieter place and really work on calming down their nervous system, taking really regular rest, and being having quite a solid routine around that. And they've been doing that, and that's made a huge difference. Their nervous system's in a much more settled place, their energy's rebuilding, they're pacing really carefully, and that was an absolute breakthrough for them at a certain stage. But then what happens is, because that was the thing that worked for them at that stage, that they then become overly rigid about the boundaries and the way they're approaching life, and having to be very careful to rest at certain points. And one of the ways that I put it is, the breakthrough at one stage can become the limitation at the next stage. And what may be true is that the next stage of the recovery path, actually what they need to do is to have more contact with the world, and actually they'll find that sometimes it's much easier to get to a calm, healing state when you're in contact with people, and it's like being really grounded and centered in the present moment. When you feel like crap and you're by yourself and you have nothing to look forward to, is actually a hell of a lot more difficult than when you're out around people that you enjoy being with, you feel nurtured by, doing something that you care about. So it's also recognizing that, and the same is of course true from a nutritional perspective, you can have a whole intervention which absolutely moves someone forward, but actually something different is needed for the next stage. So when people plateau at certain points, or when someone gets stuck at a certain point in the recovery path, what they tend to do is start doing more of what had helped them previously. But often it's a change in direction. And that's part of the subtlety and the complexity of recovery, because there are so many different things that work at different points in different ways. And, you know, as human beings, we tend to have a fairly kind of sometimes overly simplistic focus on things. We find something that works, and so we just keep on doing it.
And when we get stuck, we want to do it harder.
Yeah, exactly.
Tell me, you know, in terms of breaking through some of these plateaus, I've talked to people sometimes and I said, recovery can be a bit like peeling an onion. You know, you keep finding some new layers, you coming across new challenges that you didn't see before, and then eventually it all kind of dissolves. And do you find that, do you do certain tests? I mean, you talk about nutritional, from a nutrition point of view, do you do specific mineral testing? What kind of testing do you do?
So it's very patient specific. We have a list as long as your arm, in a sense, of different tests that we would use. There are certain core tests that we use a lot of, and they would be things like, with a lot of mitochondrial function testing, which I think at the moment is only something, the way that we do it, you can do in the UK, which basically looking at someone's cellular energy production of ATP, and that is a really good way of understanding the delayed fatigue response and that whole kind of element, which is often very puzzling for people with any chronic fatigue. So that's a test that we use quite a lot of.
Is that a muscle biopsy?
No, it's just a blood test. There's a lab in the UK that does it. We're currently, through our foundation, we're doing a research study looking at mitochondrial function, and we're using muscle biopsy there. It's kind of an area which has kind of had this whole surge in the UK, but it's one lab that do it, and they're very limited in terms of capacity, which is kind of frustrating because we would like to see it kind of more widely available. But I think it's an area to watch over the next kind of 10 to 15 years. There's a research for a university in the north of the UK which has been done at the moment looking at mitochondrial function. So I think that area is going to move, but from a clinical perspective, we have a test there that we use quite a bit. Okay. We do a fair bit of adrenal testing, We do quite a bit of stool testing. So in terms of looking at things like food intolerances, candida, gut dysbiosis, generally those kinds of areas. And then in terms of specific things that may be going on for certain patients, then it kind of broadens out to pretty much the whole list of functional testing that you would do. But you know, these things also are very much dictated by things like the financial resources of the patient, because the kind of it's really interesting for me at the moment. We're putting together plans to do a full randomized controlled trial. So the last few days I've been running the costings of doing the research study, which is really interesting, because normally when I'm speaking with a patient, I'm only really primarily aware of the cost of consultations. And what I'm realizing as I'm putting together the costings, far more expensive than actually the consultations at the clinic is all the testing and the supplements and that kind of thing.
So yeah, absolutely.
That actually can be, if you want to go into that in the kind of the full kind of detail, that can get extremely kind of in depth. But we're very mindful that most of the patients that we work with are pretty limited in terms of what they're financially able to do. And so it's working within those constraints. And, you know, also a lot of patients can be very sensitive to supplements. So again, it's finding the ways to work with that that's going to work for the individual.
Look, obviously I don't have 10 years of clinical experience like you do. However, Alex, it strikes me, you know, one thing I learned when I was doing all my medical research was that the body has an amazing ability to regenerate. And even when there are very real dysfunctions, so I'm not trying to trivialize, you know, mitochondrial dysfunctions or problems with adrenals or you know, anything like that. When we are given the right nutrition, even just through food, you know, the body can heal. I think that when you actually give it assistance, you can really accelerate that process tremendously. And I'm a very big advocate of orthomolecular medicine. But when our budgets don't allow for it, again, it comes back to the belief you were mentioning. I hope people are listening and realize that never has to be a limitation.
Yeah, you know, I think one of the ways I think it's helpful to think about the human body, and in fact, it was an endocrinologist who said this to me back when I was ill 15 years ago. He said, you know, there's nothing really that modern medicine does to fix the human body. What modern medicine does is it provides an environment where the human body can fix itself. Yeah. So, for example, you know, you get hit by a truck, and you break all these bones and all these things happen in your body. And okay, modern medicine can save your life in terms of setting those bones in the right place, taking out bits of shrapnel from the truck that's stuck in your face, whatever. You know, there are certain things that medicine can do. But then that's done. And okay, you might take painkillers to relieve the pain. You might take certain things that will kind of support certain bodily processes. But ultimately, the actual healing, the mending of those bones, for example, that is a process the body does. And it's only really in the most recent times, with some of the kind of stem cell stuff that's happening, that kind of thing, that we can even dream of the possibility of recreating some of these bodily functions that since time began for human beings have just been happening all by themselves. So the body has a remarkable ability to heal and to regenerate and to recover from things. But what it needs to do that is it needs to be in the right state for that to be able to happen. So, for example, if someone has a cut and that cut keeps getting dirty, or you keep rubbing, you know, you rub dirt on it or it gets salt in it or whatever, those things will stop that process from being able to happen. Or you break a bone and you probably won't be able to see, but my little finger was broken years ago. It didn't set properly. So it ends up, it's healed very well, it's just healed crooked. Yeah. So you have to have the right environment for that healing process to happen. And one of the things that is very true with ME chronic fibromyalgia is the very experience of having an illness where people can't tell you what's wrong with you, why it's wrong with you, how long it's going to be wrong with you for, what you need to do to get better, is that has a huge effect on people psychologically and emotionally. And I'm sure many of your viewers would be familiar with things like what we would call the maladaptive stress response, or other people would call the fight, flight, or freeze state in the body, basically an overactivation of the nervous system, which primarily happens because there's not an understanding of what's wrong, why it's wrong, how long it might be ill for. So somebody's body goes into the exact opposite state of what it needs to be to heal. And until you change that and the body comes to a calmer healing state, those natural healing processes don't work. And that's where the psychological piece can be so important. Not because it's psychological, the state's physiological, but the way to affect it is often, partly at least, going in from a psycho-emotional perspective.
Absolutely, Alex. I wholeheartedly agree. It's a bit odd actually asking questions and hearing you answer them. I feel I'm looking in the mirror a bit, except with more hair. tell me, again, just getting back to your clinical experience with people, do you find that there are very common places where people get stuck? And also, do you find that there are very common areas where you find people make breakthroughs as a group? And I understand everyone's different, but on the whole.
Yeah, I would say, well, let me answer the question in a slightly different way. From a psychological perspective, we talk about there are three stages to the recovery path. So stage one is what's called the crash stage. So that's where someone's completely physically crashed, they have no energy at all, and at that stage, the most important thing is as much quality rest as possible. Mm. And so the way people get stuck with stage one is they don't give in to their body to let it rest. So they keep fighting and they keep trying to push themselves out of that stage. So there's a place where acceptance has to happen, where people often have to readjust their life and they have to perhaps stop working, they have to take away pressures, and they have to allow their body to rest in that state. Mm. And interestingly, in that state, people are very keen to try all kinds of treatments to get things fixed, which can actually be a way of avoiding just taking that time of rest. Mm. So I'm often quite reluctant for people to try and do too many things too quickly, because there is a natural process that happens when the body is able to have that period of time of rest. Mm. When people start to come out of that phase, they go into what we call the tired and wired stage. And that's where people often are confused, because they say, I was sleeping kind of 12, 14 hours a day and I was resting a lot of the time, and suddenly I can't sleep and I feel really anxious and irritable. I think I'm getting worse. And what I would generally say is, no, what's happened is energy started coming back, but it's gone to your nervous system. So whereas before you were so tired, all you wanted to do was sleep, now you can't sleep because you have got more energy, but the energy has gone into this kind of maladaptive stress response, or this fight, flight, or freeze state. So you actually are getting more symptoms, but actually energy is coming back.
And so, that was my point earlier about the adrenal supplements
yeah.
potentially being dangerous, because you're giving a system energy, and it doesn't know how to use it.
Right, yeah. Exactly. So at that stage, things that help calm the nervous system down are super important. Also at that stage, people tend to do a lot of booming and busting, like they do this at stage one as well. But like they get energy, so they kind of go mad, then they crash again. So they dip between stage two and stage one. So whereas stage one is all about rest, stage two, from a psychological perspective, is all about calming the nervous system, getting into a healing state. Often what that partly also involves is people taking away stresses in their lives again, things that they kind of get overstimulated by. People, they gradually improve, they gradually get more energy. Often they have to be very careful in terms of how much activity they do. If they do too much, they crash down stage one, might be just for a day or two, but a week or two, and they come back stage two. When people start to come to stage three, that's where the calming of the nervous system tends to have had a pretty good effect. They're now able to have more energy to function more kind of in life. But there's this whole new piece of coming back into the world. And it's one thing to say to people, for example, I'm unable to go and do this thing that I don't want to do, because if I do it, I'm going to spend the next week in bed. When that's not the excuse, you actually have to be able to say, I don't want to go. And it's like, it's a whole new challenge psychologically for someone to really own their needs without having the excuse of the reason of being ill. Mm-hmm. So there's a whole readjustment of coming into the world. And also at that point, that's where I was kind of referencing earlier, there's a place where the whole being very careful with activity is very necessary through stage one and stage two. It becomes a hindrance sometimes at stage three, because it becomes a new source of anxiety.
That's right. Yeah.
And so at these different kind of transition points, different strategies become important. That's where I was saying the breakthrough at one stage becomes a limitation at the next stage. And also, you see these three stages through the course of the kind of the overall trajectory of the recovery path, but you also see it in mini crashes. So if somebody crashes or they do too much and they have a crash for a few days or for a week or two, whatever, they tend to go back to stage one through stage through to into stage three. Mm-hmm. I would say another place, which is part of the stage three piece, but it's also, I think, it's other dimensions to it as well, where I've seen quite a lot of people over the years that either have come to the clinic at this point, or they've spent a period of time working with a clinic where they've been stuck at this point, which is kind of around the 90-95% recovery part, which is where they're pretty much able to function in day-to-day life, but they kind of have to be careful. Like, it's not a robust recovery. Mm-hmm. And there's quite a few reasons why that can be, but one of the things which has been a kind of particular interest of mine over more recent time has been this recognition that it's like they found a way to be in a calm, healing state as long as they don't engage too fully in the world. And they almost can have a position around, you know, they burnt out, for example, in corporate life. So they kind of have this position, well, therefore corporate life is wrong and bad and it's unhealthy and shouldn't be in that environment. And of course, there's some truth to the way that a lot of structures work. They can be kind of oppressive and demand too much people and that kind of thing. But to really have a robust long-term recovery, we have to find a way to be able to function in the world of, you know, family, you know, both having, someone has their own children or their own parents or whatever, in those structures, to be able to work full-time and maintain the lessons of being in touch with themselves, being in a kind of balanced kind of place, and deal with that in the context of the wider world. And that can be quite a tricky piece for people. It's almost like they see that as what caused them to get sick, then they found this new way to live that they've got well, but how do they bring that back into the structures that caused them to get sick, as they perceive caused them to get sick in the first place. So that's just another area which I think can be very interesting.
Yeah, Alex, look, I know exactly what you're speaking of. Like, sometimes, you know, in one breath you're talking about how people trying to aim for that ultimate perfect recovery and not necessarily accept the fact that, you know, going from 30 to 70% is good. But in the next breath, I guess I'm probably partial to saying that, you know, don't stop just because it's pretty good. You've got to keep going. And I come across these people that you describe, who are, you know, 80-90% recovered, but they have become, I don't know if I want to use the word dependent, but let's just say very closely connected to the strategies that give them good health. And it's my view that these actually get associated in our nervous system. And my advice to them is, try a muffin and a coffee. And it seems crazy because they're going, well, you know, I don't do this, this makes me sick, this is, I've stayed away from this, I'm looking after my health now, I'm eating the perfect diet. And I go, try a muffin and a coffee. Just see what happens. You know, it's not about going off and living an irresponsible life, but it's about changing some of those associations so that you can make that final step of having that really robust recovery. Is that something you subscribe to, or does that sound like crazy stuff to you?
Yeah, no, not at all. There's a patient story that comes to mind on CFS recovery, where basically the last stage of her recovery was basically going out partying all night, smoking, drinking, and she was doing 2 hours of yoga a day. It was like a hardcore yogi prior to this,
yes.
And the whole thing was just going out partying. And in the end, she came back after a month of this and said, "Please, can I stop partying?" I was like, "Sure, I don't want to party. We don't want to party anymore." But it's like that was the treatment that she needed, was to blow all of those structures.
Yes.
The other thing I would say is that I've seen a lot of people get to the point where they believe they're fully recovered. And then a year or two down the line, we'll end up having some kind of, maybe they go through the practitioner training program or something.
Right.
And they'll say, "Well, I thought I was recovered, and now I've seen another level."
Yes.
Or what happens is there's a deeper robustness to recovery. So I would say getting to full energy doesn't actually, for me, equate to having achieved what I'd call a robust recovery. Because you can get to full functioning, but not have many energy reserves. So it's a little bit like if you've been badly in debt and you get to the zero point, you go, I'm now financially free. But then the next day you get an electricity bill for £500 or dollars you weren't expecting. Mm. Suddenly you're back in debt again. Mm. If you've got savings and you've got, you know, substantial savings, then you can get a bill out of the blue. And it doesn't matter because you can use your savings to deal with that. Same thing's true in terms of energy reserves. Like, for example, how well someone's adrenals are functioning long term. That if what tends to happen is once someone gets to full energy, I see there's another 1 to 2 years of gradually building those reserves in such a way that that's where you really get really robust recovery, where all hell can break loose in your life and all kinds of stress can happen. And you notice you really can deal with it and you are drawing on your reserves, but there's enough in the reserves to draw upon. And you don't become foolish in that you just draw on them forever to the eventual point that you run out. So there's a kind of, hopefully a wisdom that comes in for somebody. You know, and I do liken it to kind of a financial kind of wisdom. There's a wisdom that comes in where they recognize that if you constantly spend more than you have available, you end up with a big problem. Mm. And in the Western world, that generally equates to eventually someone comes and takes your furniture because you haven't been paying your bills. Mm. So it's a kind of same thing physiologically, that full recovery doesn't mean living your life in such a way where you think there are no boundaries and you can work 20 hours a day and party for the last 4 hours. There's a kind of maturity and kind of wisdom that comes in, but it doesn't mean you have to live this carefully protected life.
Yeah, look, I agree, and I think it's an excellent analogy, the financial analogy, because when we're talking about, you know, building your adrenals as an example, it's really only when you spend less than what you're making. So if you're spending everything, so I'm not saying you're spending more, but you're spending everything, you're not really rebuilding. And yeah. I think people have to realize that when they're feeling good, those are not bad times to rest either. And another thing that, and look, I guess my recovery is obviously a little more recent, 3 years ago as opposed to 10 years ago, so perhaps it's a bit still very fresh in my mind, but it's also that we lose a complete perspective of what is normal. Mm-hmm. And I say that from two points of view. One is, you know, I too came to a point where I was symptom-free, I was able to function, I was healthy. You say, well, that's fully recovered, right? And then, yes, 6 months later, I go, yes, I was fully recovered, but I'm now more fully recovered. Because, you know, I suddenly feel I have even more energy. And perhaps more energy even than your average Joe, quite possibly. So I think we really lose our frame of reference. And in the same breath, I think sometimes people get unrealistic expectations too.
Yeah, I know. And I think people's reference point for fully recovered is the person that burnt out and got sick, because that's the last time they remember having a lot of energy. Then that person got sick because they weren't living a balanced way. So it's not a healthy reference point. There is a readjustment, as you say, that has to happen, where somebody needs to find the way to go, what really is healthy for them? And, you know, often in life, there's all kinds of compromises we have to make. For example, you know, we'd like, you know, someone likes music, and they'd like to, you know, play the drums all day long, but they're not going to get paid to play the drums. So they have to find a balance between how they're going to earn a living and how they're going to have fun. And then maybe they have children. How does that? So there's all kinds of, and then when life gets very full, the trouble is that we want to do everything. Then we have to make more considered choices. But what are our real priorities? And having heard literally hundreds personally and overseeing thousands of cases of people with ME chronic fibromyalgia, of course, part of that conversation is how did someone get sick. So I've heard it kind of all blurs into one story that basically says was doing too much for too long in an unsustainable way, and the body, something snapped, something in the body was not unable to sustain it. So that's not full recovery. That's preparation to burn out.
Yes.
And equally, it's possible to, with full recovery, live a very, very full, very, very active life. But it's doing that in a sensible, considered way.
Which is what we all should be doing, obviously.
Yeah, I mean, one way I would say that I think is helpful to think about it is ME chronic fatigue fibromyalgia, it's a very, very difficult, challenging experience for someone to go through, but it doesn't kill you. And there are other things which, if people don't get any chronic T fibromyalgia and they keep living in that way, someone can one day drop dead from a heart attack, or they can end up with terminal cancer, for example.
Absolutely.
And so there is, you know, it doesn't sound very reassuring when someone's going through the experience, but when you have something that actually you can recover from, which has all kinds of messages and all kinds of learning in it, actually there's the potential for someone, of course, to fully recover and live a healthy kind of life on the other side. It's very different to something which is just kind of a gay member. And, you know, there are many, many people these days that get to their 50s and their 60s through a lifetime of pushing their body too hard. And, you know, I don't want to be negative about it, but it is too late, because they end up in the mortuary.
Yes.
So that's where someone, you know, I got ill in my mid-teens. And in a sense, of course, there's many lessons and many gifts from that experience. But just one of them is that I fully expect to live a very long, healthy life as a result.
Sure. Of those issues. Sure. Look, Alex, you and I could probably talk all day, but we can't. I'm going to ask just two more questions. Mm-hmm. And the first question I would like to ask is the difference between your experience in people recovering between people who have strictly CFS and ME and people who have either progressed or started more with the fibromyalgia side of things and possibly multiple chemical sensitivities. It's, you know, I guess many people actually see those as completely different illnesses for all kinds of reasons that perhaps we shouldn't go into, especially I think in the States. But have you got any particular thoughts about the different expressions of the what I would consider the same illness?
Yeah, I would say that there are clear differentiations if you look at it from a medical perspective.
Yes.
In a sense, the fibromyalgia element tends to be more medically accepted. So in a perverse kind of way, it can be a bonus to get that diagnosis, because there tends to be a little bit more understanding and context around it. That's partly because rheumatologists have found a way to get in on the kind of game, and so they've given it a legitimacy in a sense.
Yes.
Whereas on the ME chronic fatigue side, from a medical perspective, it's primarily been the psychiatric kind of group that have got in, and that's therefore given it all kinds of stigmas. From my personal perspective, I think it is dangerous to use any of those labels, because in a sense, yes, the label's helpful in terms of someone having a label for what's happening to explain to other people and to make sense of it, but none of those labels tell you anything about what's actually happening in someone's body.
It's all talking about symptoms.
Yeah, exactly. And so someone's got whatever label, the question is, what are the biochemical processes happening in that individual which are causing that group of symptoms? So it's not that I'm anti people having labels. They can be extremely helpful in terms of things like getting access to benefits, getting other people to understand what's happening, and beginning opening doors up towards treatment. Mm. But they don't tell you anything about what's actually really going on in someone's experience. Mm.
Mm. But have you found distinctions in terms of, you know, when people are having those symptoms of fibromyalgia and multiple chemical sensitivities in terms of how you help them recover and the process? I mean,
yeah.
Have you noticed some clear differences?
I would say yes, and I would say no. So I would say yes in the sense that, let's take fibromyalgia as an example. There are certain ways of working with that, both nutritionally and psycho-emotionally, which have a different flavor to how you might work with ME chronic fatigue. So you might do the same things you do with ME chronic fatigue, but you might do some more specific things. Multiple chemical sensitivity, again, you've got someone who may well not have fatigue as a primary symptom, but they've got all kinds of sensitivities that are happening. So there's a whole piece of the intervention you might not need to go down, because they've got a kind of a specific element of it in terms of what's going on. I think it's an area that would be interesting to a lot more research, and part of the problem that's happening at the moment is there's so much kind of fighting between researchers and academics in terms of what label we should have. And I don't know what the kind of state of play is in Australia, but certainly in this country, there's been a whole massive thing about whether ME chronic fatigue should be called ME or chronic fatigue. And so much energy kind of gets put in that. And the patient groups tend to fight very hard for the label of ME because it sounds more medical and it sounds more legitimate. You know, chronic fatigue syndrome is a pretty insulting diagnosis in a sense. You know, it's like, you know, you go to the doctor with a kind of bad back, and they don't go, your label is you've got a bad back. They give you something far more medical in terms of what's actually happening structurally in that instance that's causing what's going on. So I understand why patients fight against it, and there are also patients say, look, fatigue isn't even my worst symptom. You know, my worst symptom is my cognitive disturbance, for example. Yes. So, you know, so there are all kinds of debates around it that take up so much kind of resource and so much focus, it becomes unhelpful.
Yeah. It's just a word at the end of the day that we attach to the illness, but I see that in particular between ME and CFS, it creates a lot of angst. It seems to be that in this there's a lot of angst around the world with this illness, full stop.
Totally. I mean, what you've got is, you know, a lot of people that have been really seriously ill for a really long time that have been dangerously neglected by the people that are supposed to help them. Yeah. So they're seriously angry, and it's like, I get it. The anger isn't necessarily helpful, and often what ends up happening is it puts people off researching in the area because people do research studies and they get loads of hate mail from people that are ill. So it's like, I understand why people feel so rageful and angry about it. I really get it, and directing that the way they do often makes their situation worse, not better. And it further adds to the stigmatization that people with ME, chronic fatigue, fibromyalgia, have some kind of psychological thing going on. You know, even if it's justified that they're rageful and angry, it doesn't help the cause.
One other question is, when I finished writing my book, I decided to actually Google what I was talking about. And because previously I'd Google symptoms, I tried to work it all out, and now I thought, well, actually, let me actually Google what I'm saying. And then I found that there were a whole bunch of people who've spoken about this, and actually going back decades. Mm-hmm. I remember that moment very clearly because I was kind of fairly annoyed because I was kind of thinking, well, where were all these people whilst I was sick? And wouldn't it be much easier for me to Google this earlier? But it seemed difficult to connect. So my question is, now obviously what you're doing makes a great deal of sense to me, and is very much in line with what I'm trying to project for people to seek, which is why they're finding you after they read my book. Are there, do you know of many other clinics around the world and practitioners that have a similar outlook and a similar approach?
Yeah, I would say that there are, well, firstly, I would say 10 years ago, there was a whole psychological kind of thing that kind of happened, certainly in the UK. There was something called the lightning process, something called reverse therapy, something called the Gupta program. That was what we were doing. And we were all kind of vaguely interconnected with each other, kind of looking at the same kind of thing from a slightly different kind of lens. But it was a little bit like a bunch of people touching elephant, blindfolded, describing a bit, but kind of describing the same thing. So there was a whole thing that kind of happened there, and I won't go into all the details of the history around that, but you know, that had a whole effect, and that then spread out more internationally. And it was kind of, in a sense, quite satisfying to see an actual development around a major chronic illness happen in the UK. I was just like, wave the flag from the UK. I was kind of proud of that. You know, most things tend to come out of America generally, and certainly a lot of the biochemical stuff generally comes out of America. Yeah. I would say a few individuals that I think would be worth naming. Someone called Dr. Sarah Myhill, who's based in Wales, who pretty much, I would say, was the early trailblazer on mitochondrial function treatment for ME chronic fatigue. Mm-hmm. And she's somebody that we've had various dialogues over time. I think she does great work. Nikki Gratrix, who was originally director of nutrition, that originally kind of drove the nutrition protocol at OHC up until 4 or 5 years ago. She's played, I think, an important role in terms of development of these kinds of things. Ashok Gupta, who's something called the Gupta Program, he's got a kind of good approach, again, from a kind of psychological perspective in terms of what's happening. Mm-hmm. I think there's also a lot of unsung heroes. There's a lot of people, you know, that I guess people like yourself that have put bits together and in their own way kind of started putting together a program, started working one-on-one with individuals in different ways. So I think there's a lot of people doing a lot of things that are similar. You know, we've been very fortunate to work with, you know, the volume of people we have. And I guess the Optimum Health Clinic is unusual in the sense that I'm pretty sure it's the largest single organization in terms of the volume of patients that we work with kind of in-house, rather than a network of loosely affiliated practitioners having a very closely relating team. Mm-hmm. You know, it's always gratifying to see other people kind of take things from what we do and that kind of spreads out. I certainly haven't got a kind of, someone was asking me recently about intellectual property, and I was saying, you know, sure, if someone literally takes our work and puts their own branding on it, I'm kind of uncomfortable around it. But in terms of ideas, these ideas are not owned by any individual or any organization. They're ideas that are there for the patient community. At the start of this year, we actually became a charity. And so all of the profits of the work that we do, actually the clinic element is not designed to run for profit because we want to make it as accessible to patients as we can. But any profit that is generated goes to the charity that owns the organization. And we also have some generous benefactors that supported the charity. And we're currently actively fundraising for a randomized controlled trial. The aim is to get the research side moving forward enough that if the research moves forward, well, certainly in this country, and I believe it also will be true internationally, there's enough evidence for these kinds of intuitive medicine-based treatments, then over time there starts to become government funding for treatment. And that, from my perspective, is really the holy grail, because we get about 5,000 inquiries a year, and the vast majority of those people are simply unable to afford the level of treatment ideally that they would receive. And that's frustrating for everyone involved. So, you know, we've put a lot of stuff out on our YouTube channel. We have secretsrecovery.com, which has over 100 hours of supportive materials and resources at a very affordable kind of price. But ultimately, I think treatments should be funded. You know, certainly in the UK, I'm pretty sure it's the same in Australia. You know, most medical things that happen, you go to a doctor and you get treatment and you pay your tax and that's made available. I find it almost criminal that people with their lives affected the way they are with any chronic fibromyalgia are just left without any kind of quality support. So hopefully that's something that will change over time.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, I guess one of the frustrating issues there is the divide between a medication and a supplement in terms of perceived efficacy and hence, you know, funding from the government. And I think that can be a huge issue. But I also feel like, I guess the reason why I ask is I sense a certain sense of reinventing the wheel. So, you know, when I sort of did everything I did and then people would throw this and I came across programs and a lot of what people were saying, I'm like, well, that's what I'm saying. And I'm like, well, that's what I did to recover. And now here is someone who's been doing this like before I even, you know, whilst I was still in the depths of being totally ill. And so I feel like that there is a continual sense of people reinventing the wheel. And if we can share more, we would make a much bigger difference globally. And I suppose what I found unique about the Optimum Health Clinic, from what I've gathered so far, and I suppose why people, you know, who like my book went to you, is because it strikes me you focus on a multilateral approach. Now, I feel quite strongly about a multilateral approach, whilst I fully appreciate, you know, things like mitochondrial dysfunction and the psychological approach and all these different things. I think, you know, different things at different times, and often what we really need is if everyone puts their back into it, that's when we push over the bus, so to say. So it's all about, you know, using all of the strategies as opposed to just one. And so I wonder, you know, are there other people who get this, who agree with you and I in that approach and that actually use a multilateral strategy? I mean, you know, the US is such a big country. Do you know any other clinics who do that there?
I think maybe one way to put it is I gave the keynote at the main conference in the Conference of Alternative Medicine in the UK earlier this year, several hundred nutritional therapists. And I think it's from the response there, it's pretty widely accepted this is the way forward. And there's definitely more to be learned in terms of, you know, treatments are always evolving and always being understood. But the last decade, there has been such huge surge forwards in, you know, through the work that we've done and many other people that have done around the world. I think the next decade is less about, of course that will continue, but it's less about that continuing. And it's more about getting the evidence base for the effectiveness of those interventions, because that's what's going to game change the situation in terms of getting the funding. Right. ME chronic fatigue, fibromyalgia in this country costs the UK government a huge amount just in terms of paying the benefits of people unable to work because they're ill. The government need to have effective treatments, and they don't have that at the moment. Mm. So I think with the evidence base happening, that's the thing which is going to game change it. Mm. And that's very much where our focus is now as we continue to move forward with the treatments.
Alex, I want to thank you very much. I've really enjoyed our chat. Is there any final message you'd like to share with people listening? What I'm saying is, what do you think is the most important thing for people to grasp from this interview in order for them to actually start moving forward in their own recovery?
I would say maybe as a final point, the most important thing is that it is possible to find a way forward. I think it would be arrogant to sit here and say that, you know, this is the ABC that everyone needs to do. It just doesn't work like that. Mm-hmm. But it is possible for people to move forward, and they have to find a way that's going to work for them and see who they resonate with, what approach they resonate with, and, you know, to trust that process and to patiently follow it.
Alex, thank you very much for making the time to share your thoughts today.
Thanks, Dan.